I'm kind of a jack of all trades. You could say master of none, but I prefer not to get into that. But I'm a geographer by training, but I have a background in oceanography. I work on a construction management course in teaching green building. I partly have an economics background, so I do things like life cycle cost analysis. I'm sustainability from the upstream to the downstream in water. And so with this kind of background, I had started teaching the class on food and food sustainability. And through Polly, my partner, who's partner in crime, also partner in life, Polly was the culinary director for CleanFish, which is a sustainable seafood brokerage based in San Francisco. And we've been talking very much about how to kind of grow the sustainable food pipeline to be able to find products that could be brought into a market that had a story that had a human element to it, an environmental element to it, a resource-based element to it. And so from 2011 to 2014, as part of my ability to do work on top of my normal teaching load, I took on a number of small consultancies that kept me within that 25% cap, in which I could work with CleanFish and Polly and the other folks there to help kind of assess from a sustainability perspective new potential sources of seafood. And the primary focus ended up being on aquaculture products. And so recognizing that there are many people working in the sustainable seafood industry realize, of course, there are many pressure points at which you could fall foul of a market in which somebody can complain about the labor practices that go into producing the food, the environmental aspects, the humane treatment of those creatures in terms of raising and then harvesting and then finally in their dispatch, problems related to HACCP and the food safety connection from the pond to the marketplace. Many different aspects. If you look across the board, there were many areas that needed to be examined. So we got together, me from the academic side, and Polly and her colleagues at CleanFish from the downstream side, and we figured what kind of a vetting system would a sustainable seafood have to go through to kind of make sure that they could be screened for all the different aspects and red flagged for things that might cause a problem on the downstream side. It could then be addressed as part of negotiations between the company and the supplier to determine also, how quote unquote sustainable, when sustainability hadn't really been fully defined, or there were multiple definitions, how that would work. So, as an academic, I also have access to enormous body of literature. One of the things that if you try and get hold of a scientific paper and you're not in academia, you pay $50, $80 per article you're trying to get from Elsevier, etc. We have access to all of that, of course. And so one of the things we can bring is the knowledge of how to find this information and then how to process it. So a full review of the academic and scientific literature, assessment of existing certification for aquaculture, both ocean-based open water and land-based systems, and then the development. Many of us also have skills in programming spreadsheets and coding of various different computer instruments. It's putting together a screening tool that could be used to gather information from those suppliers and then take a look at it against a series of standards and come up with scores and come up with indicators where you could actually get kind of a template, a dashboard of how a particular product might perform against these criteria that then become a basis for dialogue and understanding where it's coming from. And then once that information came back from those suppliers, is assessing the data that was provided, seeing if the answers were reasonable, taking a look to see what information was developed. So clearly, I'm not going to go into the detail of what the screening tool involved. I mean, there are non-disclosure agreements and all sorts of things you have to do as an academic when you're working with the private sector, and we're often very willing to do that. But what we'd like to talk about here, and let Polly, come in and talk from when she was the director, when she was there, why engage with an academic? And so from my perspective, a seafood brokerage that's really dealing with the commercial side of things, the personnel there won't have the technical knowledge or expertise on sustainability, on the science, on the policy, in many cases to understand the full range of aspects that may import this. Sustainable seafood is really a broad mix of like industrial issues, scientific, social science criteria. It's constantly evolving, it constantly needs updating. Who has the time to do that? Well, cost effectively, your academic partners have the time to do that, because in all probability, they're doing it anyway, because that's what their field of expertise is, and they're teaching to that, and we have to stay current if we're doing teaching and doing research. And so the idea of coming up with a screening tool, complex process, identifying critical information, it really needs to, I think, have a skill set that an academic environment can often, you know, provide you with, particularly the CSU, right? Where predominantly we're teaching and doing research for the benefit of our students who are going to go out and join the workforce. So, you know, we have a lot of applied, you know, practically based skills and research that we do. So my involvement with industry was not RFP based, it was an organic development process, it relied on personal connections, and I'd like to give Polly the chance to present from her perspective why she and the company she represented would choose to work with an academic, you know, and choose to work with the scientists from the CSU.
Okay, hi everybody. So I'll make it really, really brief, but what I found myself in the situation of being out in the field talking with people who were also very up on all of these questions, and I needed to find a way to be defensible. Were the products that we were bringing to the marketplace actually what they said they were? How did we have a third party come in? And so basically by working with the CSU, it brought in a neutral body, and it brought in a knowledge base that I didn't have access to, so they could help me make sure that what we were doing was accurate, it was reliable, it was an impartial viewpoint that brought in that information that we didn't have, and it was really, really important. So when I found myself out in the field bringing a product from either a wild source or a farm source that was maybe on the bleeding edge, so it yet hadn't yet been evaluated by a current NGO or a system that had been in place, using the CSU system and using the knowledge base that was in there kind of allowed us to say, okay, this is something that we can back, or this is something that we can't back. And it gave a whole lot more credibility once we got out into actual commercial transactions and helping companies with their procurement policy and matching them up. So that's basically why and how we worked together, and it worked really, really well. So
valuing the objectivity, the neutrality, I mean, you know, we won't have necessarily a dog in the fight. So, you know, it's not like the academics are interested either way whether this product gets taken on or not. The idea was present the facts as we see them, not worrying about the implications of whether that would invalidate or validate a particular product. It's just trying to say, okay, this is how, you know, objectively the world will see this product based on these sets of criteria that are out there in the world. It's, you know, it removes the desire to, what we felt, the desire to you know, cut corners per se. And I think that the impartiality of academics is something that can be a really important tool, because it gives you the chance to have somebody, you know, tell you straight up, you know, what's the scoop on this? What is the way this will be perceived in the marketplace using all of these important criteria?
It also kept the producers that we were dealing with, it can keep them in line, because then they don't just attach their, you know, their donkey cart to one particular set of criteria, bringing in a whole range of things from animal husbandry to community impacts to, you know, all of these more diverse sets of criteria kept everybody very much in check, and it kept that process of innovation.